Hey friends, welcome back. Gabriel Kevin here, and another installment in my music tutorials. And today we're going to talk quickly about distribution. So what do you do with your end product when you're done and you have it mastered and you want to get it out there and show the world and become a super mega star? That's what I want to be, so maybe I am. Okay, so distribution, and there's all kinds of stuff out there to do research. Please do your research, do your homework, become an educated person so you know what's going on and you make your right decisions. So the more educated you are, the better decisions you'll make. And the other two things I want to talk about today is copywriting and also performing rights organizations and a little bit about contracts. Now, I am not a lawyer. I am not giving legal advice. I'm only saying my opinion. And it's just a commentary on my opinion and things that I've done. So this is not any legal advice. This is just things that I do for myself. And I know other people do. So you may know some of this stuff, but it might be good to listen through just to hear some things that you, oh, I didn't know that. Or there's some questions. So there's some things I just don't still get yet. And I've researched, and maybe we can help each other and put some things into the comments and say, yo, hey, Gabriel, hey, community, I know about this. This is what happened, that, and put it out there. And cool. So let's talk about distribution. So you took the journey from writing a song, or you work with co-writers, you did all the stuff that's in all my tutorials. Now, you do all the stuff, you do the recording, you set up your studio, you do your recording, you get your equipment, you do your mixing, you do your engineering, you do your mastering, you do your production, all that stuff, and you have this product, and here we are. What do I do with it? So you can create CDs, sell them at shows. You can create CDs and put them on Amazon and places like that. And then most likely you're also going to do streaming platforms or iTunes for downloads. So the streaming platforms, I think, are fairly common, at least the popular ones, Spotify, Pandora, Deezer, stuff like that. And you have the iTunes for like downloads and things. Okay, so we all know about that, hopefully. So how do you get there? So I think some years back, you were able to, as an individual, go to Spotify and be able to put your music out there as an individual. I don't think they do that anymore. I do know that they are now looking at the aggregators. So what's an aggregator? An aggregator means summing up, aggregate. And most of the streaming platforms, if not all of them, are looking for only your music through an aggregator, through a third party. The aggregator, they take like a CD Baby, a TuneCore, a DistroKid, et cetera, and they will get myself, you, everybody else, and put you all together when you are releasing your stuff and send it to Spotify, send it to Pandora. So the Spotifys of the world and the Pandoras of the world don't have to deal with 14 million people sending them stuff. So that it's like a funnel, okay? Nothing wrong with it. It's perfect. It's fine. And that's how you get your stuff out there. So do some research, tons of videos and things out there on TuneCore, on CD Baby, on DistroKid, and there's other ones. So they're the three I'm going to talk about right now. So you have to make a decision in terms of what's best for you. I am not promoting any of them. I started with CD Baby years and years ago in the time of the Romans. No, years ago, I started with CD Baby, and there weren't a lot of aggregators out there, but now there are a fair amount. And I, a couple years back, moved to DistroKid, and I'll tell you why. And this is because my preference, so take it for what it's worth. So each one of these, you have to go to their website, you look at their marketing. Now they're going to be marketing and try to get you to go with them, which is fine. It's just like buying a car. And look at find the place on the website where they distribute to. I almost guarantee you that between those three, at least, CD Baby, DistroKid, and TuneCore, they're going to hit all the major ones, and they're going to hit a lot of other ones. Some have more than others. Some you look at and go, I never even heard of that thing. But hey, it's a platform, so there's somebody listening to it there. So it's not necessarily means that you have to go and take the one that has the most. You just want to take the one that fits you right. Now, that can be, wow, what tools do they offer? So look in the website and find out, okay, after I join you, how do you help me do whatever? And some tools could just be videos, tutorials. Some are actual, they create little website things for you like DistroKid does. And so yada, yada, yada. Okay, so look at their marketing, look at where they distribute to, look at the tools and the videos and the things that they help you with, and see if that's ongoing too. Sometimes some places, and I'm not saying any of these, but sometimes they put out some tutorials and it's like 5 years old or 3 years old, and then they don't give you new content all the time. So that's another thing to look at. And the other one is cost. And that's probably one of the bigger ones that most people make a decision on. So how do you decide? Well, and this is right now, August 2022. And this is things that I remembered. I haven't, just like yesterday, researched all these again to tell you. I'm just going to tell you what I remember and what I do believe, how they operate. If they have changed since the time I looked at it, then they changed. So again, don't just take my word. I'm just giving you some rough ideas about this. And the reasons why I changed from CD Baby to DistroKid, and I almost went to TuneCore. Okay, so costs. CD Baby, I love them. They have a lot of tools. They have a lot of downloads, documentation that you can get, and it's great. So, and they have great support. All of them have great support. So CD Baby will charge you for an initial charge for an album to come out, which is more than one song. I believe it is defined as an album. So an EP would still be an album. I'm not sure if it's like $49 or something like that. Look at what it is now. And then they'll charge you if you're just going to do a single for that single. So every time you put an album out, you have to pay that. Every time you put a single out, you got to pay that. But you don't have to pay that anymore after that. It's just a one-time shot. But they do take a percentage of your royalties. And the last time I looked, it was around 9%. That's not that bad. So if you are somebody who's doing it more in a hobby mode, or you're semi-serious, but you don't have any intent to, you know, have millions and millions of streams, it's not your intent, you're just doing this because you want to do it, and it's fun. That 9% is probably not going to hit you that hard, because you're not going to be, if 9% on what? On $100,000, what's 9%? $90,000?
Oops,
that's a lot.
I'm at 9,000.
So when you get up to high numbers, that 9% becomes more significant, right? If it's in low numbers, it's not that significant. So if you just want to pay a one-time fee and you don't worry about that percent, CD Baby's a good choice. TuneCore, I believe, and again, this is what I remember, so you have to still check, so don't take this as gospel. TuneCore will charge you for each of your albums and singles an annual fee. They will not take a percent. So you don't have to worry about the 9% thing. They don't do that. But they will take every year, if you have five albums out there, they'll charge you for those five albums when you start, and annually you'll get charged again, and annually you'll get charged again, et cetera, et cetera. But they don't take a percentage. They do have, just like CD Baby, a very robust services, the site, the tools, excellent. So it depends on if you feel that's worth it for the things that they provide. Again, personal choice, financial choice. And then DistroKid model is you pay an annual fee like TuneCore, but you can put as many things out there as you want for that fee. So it's not per album and stuff. You pay a fee, and there's a structure broken down, but you pay that fee every year, but you can put as much out there as you want. So there's three different models. Which one's right for you? Go look, research, and check it out. But that's kind of the underlying how they work. Now, they may have changed, so definitely go check to see what the current thing is today. And then make a decision, make a very educated decision, and look at reviews, look at everything, and you know, I did the same thing. Started again with CD Baby because it was one of the few ones out there at the time, so there wasn't much choice of different things to pick from. And then I was thinking of changing because I intend to make a lot of money out of this, like we all want to. And I don't want to pay that 9%. The main reason why I left CD Baby was the 9%. That's me. So I looked at TuneCore and I thought between TuneCore or DistroKid. So what did Gabriel think? So what I thought was, I easily amuse myself. So what I thought was, and I researched everything about them, and they have great tools. It was an even playing field to me. There are some things in DistroKid that I did like that I'm going to go into, but let's just talk about the cost thing. I felt the services were so close, and neither of those two take a percentage of your royalty. Now, we're talking about the royalty of streaming and stuff like that, and I'm not talking about PRO, Performing Rights Organization, and them becoming, somebody becoming an administrator for you with an ASCAP or a BMI. I'm not talking about that. There is a percentage in those things, and you have to look that stuff up yourself. So I'm thinking, like, every year I got to pay. If I have five albums out there, I got to pay the same thing over and over again for those five albums just to exist on TuneCore. That wasn't really something. I thought, well, wait a minute. If I just pay this one thing over at DistroKid, and I'm only talking about the financial side, pay this one thing at DistroKid, I can put as many as I want. I'll pay it annually, but I can put out as many as I want. And I thought, okay, well, that kind of sways me to DistroKid. And I'm not, everybody has a different financial situation. The difference to me wouldn't have been that much, but the other thing that swayed me was when I looked at DistroKid, it just seemed a little bit more agile to me. It just seemed a little bit more ahead of the game, and that's just me. And I looked at some of the videos, and do this. Look at some of the videos the owner, one of the owners, the founders, puts out. And it's always up to date. There's always something new coming out. And there's stuff I'm like, well, that's pretty cool. I didn't know that. Well, that's pretty cool. I didn't know that. And not that that's not on TuneCore or CD Baby. I just got a better feeling out of DistroKid. I was on the fence. So not dissing either any of them. I'm just saying this is the decision I made, and this is why I made a decision. Now look at everyone and do your research and make your decision. So there, that's that. And folks, you know, put into the comments who you have or who you had and you changed and the reasons why. And let's all just talk about it. It's good stuff. And honestly, I was so almost with TuneCore, but I went to DistroKid because I was leaving CD Baby. It wasn't like, you know, any other reason. Okay, so they're all great. Go out there and find the one that's right for you and do research and, you know, check it out. Okay, let's move on. Copywriting. You need to copyright. Look at me in the eyes. You need to copyright. You don't need to put it in the thing in the mail and put it in the mail it back to yourself. No. You need to register with the Copyright Office of the United States Government of America. Thank you. And I approve this message. So if you go to www.copyright.gov, and it's copyright, C-O-P-Y-R-I-G-H-T, not W-R-I-T-E. It's a right. It's a right of having a right. And you go there, and you just go to the electronic link in there, and it brings, you can register your name, you get a password, and now you have an account with the Copyright Office. And through that, you can copyright your material, and you want to copyright the music, and you want to copyright the lyrics. Okay, copyright says that you, and let's assume that you're the only songwriter. Now, if you had multiple songwriters, of course, all of you have to be on the copyright. In a copyright, it doesn't denote the percent of what you did. So if you go on a copyright, you can write that you did the music, and my friend here did the lyrics, and you can say, what was your contribution to the copyright? I did the music, and he or she did the lyrics. Or I did everything, so I write down music and lyrics. I think you say music and words. But you don't say the percentage. So if you three of you did the music, you're going to be equally three on that copyright. So, okay, cool. So what's the cost? I think the last time I looked, it was $35 for one work. And it was $55 for multiple works. So I tend to, if you have an album of five songs, just do one copyright, put all five on there, and pay the $55. Okay, that's not a lot of, I don't know anybody's financial situation. That's not a lot of money for the other side of it, if you don't do it, what it could cost you. And people stealing your stuff, and then becoming famous, and you have very little ability to sue and go to court if you don't have it registered with the Copyright Office. When you have it registered with the Copyright Office, that's what the court's going to look at. Now, I'm not a lawyer. This is what I've read, so I'm not giving you legal advice. Period. I am not giving you legal advice. I'm just telling you what I know from what I've researched. So you got to check it out yourself. Check out copyright law. Go to the government site. It has a lot of stuff. It tells you what copyrights are about and all this stuff. Go do your research. I'm only telling you what I believe that I have done over the years. The other thing that's interesting with copyright, so, and this is going to be important, because when do you copyright it? When do you do that action? Hey, I just wrote the song. I didn't put any bass guitar. I didn't do anything. I just kind of wrote this song. And say you write it on an acoustic guitar and you have some words and you've worked out the vocal melody. Okay, that's a song. I believe if you go to the copyright website and you do research, and this may have changed, but check it out. I'm only putting it out there so it gives you something to go check out and not take my word as gospel. That a work, and by the way, there are different types of copyrights. There's the PA form, which is the performing arts form. That would be the one that you would do for your music as a writer, as the creator of the words and the music. There is the, is it SD or SE? And no, I'm sorry, it's SR. Hmm. Sound recording copyright, which is a newer thing. It wasn't many, many years ago, they never had sound recording copyright. You need to do both. You need to do the PA, and yes, you're going to submit fees for both. Sorry. You need to do the PA one, which protects you as the writer of the composition, as the owner of the composition because you wrote it. You need to do the SR one, sound recording, because if you do all the stuff that we're talking about, my tutorials or other people's tutorials, and you have all your equipment and you record it and you put all your production in there and the strings and the drums and the bass and all that stuff, and you build all that together and you record it and you master it, you have what? You have a sound recording. That's copyrightable. What? Yeah, it is. So you want to copyright the fact that you created it, and you want to copyright the fact that you created the sound recording. Now, why did that come out? Why is there a sound recording? And I'm going to get back to when the copyright actually occurs. The sound recording is needed. You need to have the copyright of the sound recording for when you are, if your music plays on an internet radio, Sirius, stuff like that, there's a company called Sound Exchange. And that company collects royalties. So you should join Sound Exchange. I'm a member of Sound Exchange. It's basically soundexchange.com. Go do the research, check it out, and you will put out your sound recordings to that place. Because those royalties, for some reason, those royalties are paid based on the sound recording, not the PA performing arts copyright. The performing arts copyright gets those royalties get paid out through the PRO, the Performing Rights Organization, ASCAP, BMI, etc. So the ASCAP, BMI, and SECSAC, and all those that are the PROs, Performing Rights Organizations, pay to the copyright holder of who created it. That would be the PA form. Sound Exchange pays it to the sound recording. That's big difference, right? So if I covered a song that I didn't write and I create a whole different version of it, like if I did Rebel Rebel or something by Bowie, but I did a whole different version, I added different instruments, I did the tempo differently, but it's still Rebel Rebel. I don't own Rebel Rebel as a PA form copyright creator. That would be Bowie or whoever owns it now. So they will get the PRO copyright because they get the mechanical royalties. And go look at, get some books. Donald Passman, I believe, has a great book out there that he's always updating. And it tells all about the business of the music business, the business of the music business, and all this legality stuff, I highly recommend getting that book and reading it, and look up copyrights and stuff like that. It's really good. So that's what I did. So, and plus I know a lawyer. So if I cover that song and the sound recording that I create of that, I own. That's the SR one. I created the sound recording. And when I put that out there, Sound Exchange is going to pay me. And then if it gets played on a commercial radio or college or whatever, you know, the commercial radios, you know, you're like your WSMD, whatever radio station, that they pay the BMI and the ASCAPs, and you get the, and the copyright holder gets that. Okay? So it gets complicated. Read up on it. Educate yourself. But at least the bottom line, copyright. Pay the fee. Get it registered. And in your account, so all the ones that you've registered, it's all right there. You are safe. If anybody steals it, either your sound recording or they steal your actual song and try to do something with it, you have the ability to go to court. Again, this is not legal advice. This is just information I'm passing on for you to go and check it out and get your own legal advice, either through books or through a lawyer or whatever. If you're making this amount of money, then you don't care, probably. If all of a sudden you have a hit and somebody stole it, or somebody stole your song and you didn't copyright it and they make a hit out of it, you have a really hard time, I believe, trying to prove that you wrote that song. Okay, so let's finish up on copywriting. Check this out on the copyright website. The moment something is copyrighted is when it's first fixed into a recording. What? So when I wrote the song on the guitar, it wasn't copyrighted? No. But if I took that song and through my Studio One or Pro Tools or whatever, and today I recorded it, I fixed it onto a recording, something like that. There's a phrasing like that. Look it up on the site. I fixed it onto a recording. Once it's on a recording, it's immediately copyrighted. So, well, hey, Gabriel, why do I have to go then send the form in and send the fee in? Because it's, why do they do this? I don't know. But they say it is copyrighted at the moment that you fix it into a recording. But in order to defend yourself in a court, it's so much better to have it registered, because there's now a fixed copy at the place where all the copyrights are, called the United States Government Copyright Office. Research it. Decide what you want to do. I'm not giving legal advice. I'm just giving you things to think about and things to go look out there for. Okay. So the only thing I would say be careful of, if you wrote a song and you record it with some friends, but you wrote it and you put that down, fixed down into a recording, there could be the argument, probably, that they're all in the copyright because they're all there at the time it was recorded. I don't know. That's something I always wanted to check with a lawyer. But, you know, check it all out. Just all I'm saying is, the only thing I'm giving advice for is to please copyright your material, protect your material. Okay, let's go to PROs. We already kind of touched base on that with Sound Exchange. So the PROs are the SECSACs, the ASCAPs, the BMIs. Sound Exchange is for the sound recordings. And if I'm saying anything wrong or somebody says, nah, Gabriel, you're not right, it's really this, put it in the comments. I'm just trying to pass information. What I'm really trying to do is make you think and make you research and make you educate yourself and then make your own decision. Not because I said it or anything, just because you wanted to go out there and learn. I'm a big proponent of getting educated as much as you can before you make a decision. Okay, so what about this PRO stuff? Within CD Baby and within TuneCore, they have services. I think if you do the CD Baby Pro service, Pro, PRO, they will act as your administrator. I'm not sure if I get this right, but they're going to act as your administrator, and they'll help you get your stuff out to the ASCAPs and the BMIs and stuff like that. Which ones they do, I don't know. I never did it. And TuneCore has, I think, a similar kind of thing where you can put it out there, and I believe when the royalties come in, I think they take a percentage, it might be 20% or something like that. So if you don't want to go out there and join these rights organizations yourself, it's a great service. They do it for you, and they take a percent because they're doing it for you, and you're done. It's good. So what do I do? Well, being the complete control freak that I am, I actually am a member of ASCAP. So I joined ASCAP. I'm actually on SoundExchange. And you also have SoundScan, Nielsen, I believe it is, Nielsen, SoundScan, for, and this was when you could buy CDs and they would scan it and it would register that a CD was sold. And that would go to, and that would register with SoundScan, and they're still there. So I'm not sure how they interface directly because there's not a lot of CD sales in stores. But that's another thing to research. So why did I do my own ASCAP? Well, first of all, it's not that hard. It's like, it was a one-time fee of $30 to be a writer. And there's another half of that, another $30, I think it's $30, $35, whatever, to be the publisher. Well, what are you talking about? What I'm talking about is for the performing rights organizations, not the Sound Exchange, for the performing rights organizations, there are two entities. One is the writer, which would be you, me, and one is the publisher. Because the publisher is the one publishing the music. Now, I would advise, I'll put it this way, I will never give up my publishing rights. The Beatles gave up their publishing rights to get some money, I believe, to create their record label, Apple, I believe. You can research that. But I would, and from that lesson, I would never give up my publishing rights. So when you copyright something, you get a lot of rights. You get the publishing rights, you get the distribution rights, you get all these rights under that copyright, and you can sell pieces of that off. So a publisher is the one who is allowed to publish the music. Publish, put it out there. So if somebody wanted to come and do, you know, hey, I want to use your song for something like this, the publisher is the one that has to okay that. So do you have to go out and get a publisher? No. When you copyright it, you are the publisher. You own the publishing rights, so you are the publisher. Unless you sold off your publishing rights, you are the publisher. Because you own the publishing rights. That's a new language. Publishing rights. So you own the publishing rights. So they have to come to you. I want to use this for a TV show. Well, you got to come to the guy who's the publisher, who is the person who owns the copyright, because I haven't sold the publishing rights. I hope that makes sense. So again, get Donald Passman and any other kind of books like that. It's a lot to read, but when you start reading, you go, wow, what happened to me? I started reading it. I'm like, I want to keep reading this. I want to know. I want to know as much as I can. And all I'm doing here is not advice again, no legal advice, nothing. I'm just saying these are areas you want to go look into and make your own decision, because some of it might have changed. So anyway, within ASCAP, and I believe this is true of BMI and all of them, and these are the performing rights organizations, the PROs, the royalty that comes in, say from a commercial radio airplay, gets split evenly. I don't think you designate the percent. Gets split evenly between the writer and the publisher. I don't know why that's been like that, but it gets split evenly between the writer and the publisher. Now, if you have the copyright and you haven't sold any of your rights away, you are the writer, you are the publisher, you get all of it. Done. But you have to designate it that way. They'll ask for who's the writer and who's the publisher. So I registered as a writer and I registered as a publisher. And my songs have me as the writer and the publisher. So all the royalties come in, I get both halves. It was funny because years ago, they used to say that the writer, they changed it, I believe, not recently, but sometime back. The writer gets 100% and the publisher gets 100%. First time I read that, I'm like, well, that doesn't make mathematical sense. But it does, because, kind of does. They look at it that if you have multiple writers, if the writer, it's like within the writer, is 100%, and you can split that out to between five people, and each person gets 20% of the writer percent. So it helps break down the, if there's more than one writer, you're thinking 100% of the writer part. And then there's a publisher, it could be multiple publishers. So they've changed that, I believe recently, that it's 50%, 50%, which adds up to 100%. So it makes a little more sense, but it's the same thing. So I did that because I wanted to manage my own royalties coming in that from there. Now, the royalties that are paid from streaming platforms come in through DistroKid, because that's the only way I can get to the streaming platform. And the SoundExchange ones, I joined SoundExchange because some of these aggregators do not deal with SoundExchange, and I don't want to lose any royalties anywhere if things get played on internet radio, et cetera, So I joined them all. It doesn't cost anything to join SoundExchange, at least the last time I looked. And you register your songs there, and then you can either use the services from the TuneCores and the CD Baby types, and they'll take care of the PRO stuff, but they're going to take 20% or whatever the percentage. Up to you, researchers, decide. It didn't take much time for me to join ASCAP, have my account, put my songs out there, and I was done. And it's out there, so they know who to pay. The only thing that I wasn't sure of was this, and I don't know, and I tried to find out, but I don't know. So remember, with an ASCAP, there's the writer part and there's the publisher part. So when you go to one of the aggregators and they have a service and they put it out there for you, what I don't know is, do they become the publisher? I tried to ask that question to some of the aggregators, and I didn't get a clear answer, so I wasn't sure. Maybe not. Maybe you're still the writer and publisher, and they're getting the admin fee. I don't know. So if anybody knows those services, do they become the publisher? I know you stay the writer, but do they become the publisher, and that's what they take their percent from? Or do they just admin it, and you're still the writer, and they'll just take 20% of the overall cut? I do not know. If anybody knows, please put it in the comments. I tried to research it. I bailed on the research because I just decided to join ASCAP myself, so it became irrelevant for me. Anyway, a lot of stuff to look into, huh? Distribution, if you haven't already. Copyright, if you're not copywriting, do it. Do it the minute you have something recorded. Just do it, okay? And if you want to wait and you want to have it, you know, for the sound recording, you have to wait till the sound recording's done. So just time it wherever you want to time it, you know. But I would not, me personally, I write a song and I do a quick record of it and I want to send it to a bandmate and say, hey, can you look at this and see, you know, can you add to it, whatever? I'll copyright that before I send it. It takes 2 seconds, I'll copyright it. The song's copyrighted. If I update it, I'll just recopyright it. I'll just re-update it. So anyway, so we went through copyrighting, rights organizations. And the last thing I want to talk about is, by the way, on SoundExchange, the way they work it is they have the feature artist and they have the musicians. I think that's what they call it. So the feature artists are the ones that are going to get, I believe, 95% of the royalty. And there's a 5% bucket that's saved for the musicians that played on the sound recording. Remember, they're paying based on the sound recording. So if you, I want to say Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers, and I don't know if that's the way it is, but that's just kind of an idea. You have the main person, and then you have that person's musicians who, you know, they just add it to, I'm thinking like, hey, bass player, can you put a bass line here? And this is what I'm kind of hearing as a bass line. And they do it. So, you know, you're still kind of writing it, and they're actually doing the performance of it on the recording. They get a percent. They get I think it's a 5% aggregate, and you get the 95%. But check it out. But I just wanted to give you that idea that they have a thing, featured artists and musicians kind of thing broken down in that, and just look at it and maybe there's, you know, I haven't looked recently, but you want to double check and always get the most up-to-date information of any of these things that we're talking about. The last thing I want to talk about is contracts. Again, I am not a legal person. I'm not a lawyer. I'm not giving you or anybody else legal advice. All I'm saying is what I do. I have a contract presented to me for any reason whatsoever, whether it is a DistroKid contract, and they all have contracts, you have to sign a contract. It makes sense. You're going into a legal agreement with them because there's money involved. Or if I'm looking at a car lease, that's a contract. Or a purchase of a home, that's a contract. And there's tons of contracts out there. Some are short, some are long. What does Gabriel do every time? Gabriel will read the whole contract, probably twice. I'll make notations of things I don't understand or things that I'm questioning, and I'll ask questions about it because I want to know for sure what I'm getting into. This is what I do. You do what you want to do. My point to myself, as I look at myself and I say, why do you read every contract? And if I'm doing a lease agreement for a car, I'll say, excuse me, I need time to read this or take it home or whatever. You know, and never get pressure sale. I will not get pressure sale. I'll just walk out. If you're trying to force me to rush to sign something, I'm not going to do it. So I'll go through it. And my point to myself, also I was pointing to myself. My point to myself was that, hey, if somebody, now think about this. If somebody took the time, or a company took the time, to write out every word in that document, and it could be multiple pages, it could be multiple addendums, it could be all kinds of stuff. This is the way I think. They took the time to write all that stuff and all those paragraphs and the legal terminology and this and that and everything. I firmly believe that they had a lot of lawyers or one lawyer or whatever going through and writing that and reviewing it and adjusting it so that the contract works for them. And the contract should work for you too, because it's a joint thing you're getting into. But if they did all that stuff and they didn't know the contract in and out, backwards and upside down, shouldn't you do the same thing? Well, that's what I do. I'll read it. If I don't understand something, I'll question it. If I don't get an answer to a question, I'll have to. Sometimes I'll send it out to a lawyer friend of mine and say, hey, look at these two contracts. Which one do you think is more restrictive? Which one do you think is more, you know, whatever. So get your own legal advice. Don't use me. I'm not a lawyer, and I'm not giving legal advice. I'm just saying, what do I do? And maybe it'll trigger something in your head to do something. I will then send it out to a lawyer friend of mine. Or if I'm not sure and it seems minor, I may take the risk and say, it's a cause about this little thing over here. This is me. I'm not going to worry too much about that. If I ask a question and I don't get the answer I want, then I have to make a decision of whether to proceed or not. So basically, you know, get your own lawyer, make your own decisions, do what you want to do. If you want to read a contract, read it. If you don't want to read it, don't read it. I have to say this. I am not giving legal advice. I'm just saying what I do and areas that you should just look into. So hopefully that helps. And I'm not promoting any of the ASCAPs or BMIs. I'm not promoting the TuneCores or the CD Babies or DistroKids. I'm just saying what I did and these areas that I think that you should look into and make your own decision. So that's it for this. We are at 38 minutes unless I edit it down. And I just wanted to just add this stuff out there as something to think about and things to research. You know, there's more to all this stuff than a tool like a Studio One or a Pro Tools. And there's the creativity that you do, and then there are the places to get it out there. And what's great is we have the ability of the individuals to go out there and put their music out there without going through a record label. Nothing wrong with a record label, but when I was growing up, you couldn't go anywhere without a record label because they had to put out the money for the vinyl, so they're putting out a ton of money and the competition was fierce. Now you can just do it yourself. But now that you're doing it yourself, you should be educated. That's what I think. So hopefully this helped. Please put stuff in the comments, any ideas that you have, any questions that you have. If there are legal questions, then you should really go to a lawyer. If they are just generalized questions or clarifications, then I will try to answer them, or somebody else can answer them in the comments. But, you know, copywriting and stuff like that, you know, all I'm going to say is, whether you like it or not, it's serious business. The music industry is a business, like any other business. So if you're going to delve into it seriously, you should learn the business. Again, Donald Passman, great book. That'd be a great starting point. There's a couple other ones. I forget the, I just got it recently. It's about more on royalties and stuff like that. And so I'll cross-check. I'll read one book, and then I'll get another book that's on the same topic and just read that too, and always look at the edition. You know, if the thing's 10 years old, that might not be very valid today because things change really fast. Okay, hopefully this was helpful. Now we're at 40 minutes. Please put comments in if you want to, you know, if this is beneficial to you and you like what you're hearing with my other tutorials and my non-music tutorials. Please subscribe because I'm constantly putting out stuff, and that helps me out and helps you out. Please like it if you liked it. And to me, the most important one is please share it. If you know somebody who's getting into this and they're, you know, what DAW do I buy, or what, you know, what's the best thing? What is an audio interface? What's the best mic to get? You know, pass on my tutorials and hopefully that helps them, and then do further research. I always say I'm not the end all be all on everything, but it's a good starting point a lot of times. Hopefully this helps. Have a great, beautiful day. Take care.